Welcome back, everyone. We're starting a little bit later than planned, so thank you so much for your patience. I don't know about you, but I was loving looking at those pictures, though I must admit they were painfully poignant, seeing all those people gathered live together in one place, clearly enjoying each other's real physical company. So hopefully we'll be back to that before too much longer. We do continue straight away now with our next plenary. It looks at current challenges to multilateralism from an African perspective. And at a time when in some quarters it has become fashionable to cast aspersions on multilateralism, Africa actually has remained a champion of shared institutions. The UN Economic Commission for Africa, for example, was established over 60 years ago, while the African Union, descended from a parent organization only slightly younger, has strengthened its effectiveness and moved to lower trade and regulatory barriers. Yet, with the COVID-19 crisis exposing gaps and weaknesses at both the global and national levels, vulnerable communities in the global south are facing new risks, and that is very much true for people in Africa. Can the current crisis become an opportunity for Africa to reposition itself at the forefront of a new multilateralism? That is our topic over the next hour, and we have a roster of outstanding leaders to address it. I'm pleased to hand over now to the session facilitator. Dr. Brahima Coulibaly is Vice President and Director of the Global Economy and Development Program at Brookings and former Director of the institution's Africa Growth Initiative. Welcome.
Thank you, and good morning, good afternoon, and good evening, everyone, depending on where you are. We're glad you are able to join us, and I hope both you and your loved ones are all keeping very safe. And thanks for the Club of Madrid for organizing this fascinating conversation on multilateralism and specifically focusing on the challenges unique to Africa. Just this morning, I received some news that Ngozi Okonjo-Iweala would be the next Director General of the WTO, which is a one key institution in the multilateralism. And she is of African descent. And I think this is great news, both for the world and for Africa, given her tremendous experience. And I'll be interested later on to hear the panelists' thoughts on what this could also mean for Africa in terms of opportunities. Before I introduce the panelists, which we're really fortunate to have, a really distinguished setup, I will offer a few remarks to kind of put this a little bit in context. Personally, when I think about the multilateralism, I found it useful to think about it in terms of also globalization. And what globalization has done well, what it has, well, it has fallen short, particularly when it comes to Africa. I think it's becoming increasingly accepted and apparent that globalization has not really, has worked well for some, but not for others. For its benefits, it has helped lift hundreds of millions of people out of poverty over the past decades. But there's also increasingly a large segment of the global economy that is feeling shortchanged. Among them, you can count working class and rural communities in the advanced economies, but also hundreds of millions of people in emerging and developing countries, particularly Africa. And I believe that discontent is what's fueling the current backlash against globalization and leading some to call for more isolationism or deglobalization. But I believe a better governance system is the solution, not isolationism or deglobalization, but a better governance system that is able to respond to the current and emerging challenges. And central to that governance, global governance system, is a stronger multilateralism that is better fit for purpose. So a multilateralism system that we should reimagine as a means for empowering people and enhancing social and economic equities to deliver prosperity for all. And clearly, the current system has not delivered prosperity for Africa, at least not at a large enough scale. if you just look back at the past four decades, the income per capita in the region has stagnated at about 12% that of the advanced economies. Global poverty is getting increasingly concentrated in the region. And African policymakers are feeling also the challenges of climate change, even though the continent contributes the least to global warming. The countries are struggling with mobilizing domestic resources at a time when cross-border taxation is not working to their advantage. And we've seen this during the COVID moment when it hit, with many of the countries struggling to gather resources to be able to create enough fiscal space to not only support, fight the pandemic, but to support the economies. And if anything, the lack of coordination that we've seen during the pandemic has actually, in my view, marked a pinnacle of some of the deficiencies we have in the current multilateral system. So then the key question is, from what is the view on the current challenge to multilateralism from an African perspective, and whether we can consider the current global crisis as an opportunity for Africa to reposition itself at the forefront of the new multilateralism. And as I mentioned, we're truly fortunate to have a distinguished panel of experienced leaders in policy making across Africa and the world, whose insights will be very invaluable for the conversation. We have His Excellency Chissano Joaquim, former president of Mozambique and a current member of the Club de Madrid. He also served as president of the SADC Committee for Cooperation in Political Affairs, Defense, Security, and as a president of the African Union. Welcome, Your Excellency.
Thank you.
Second panelist is His Excellency John Kufuor, former president of Ghana and also a member of the Club de Madrid. He served as the chairman of the regional community ECOWAS and also as the chairperson of the African Union. Welcome, His Excellency. The third panelist is Excellency Aminata Touré. She's former Prime Minister of Senegal and also a member of the Club de Madrid. Aminata Touré is also a special envoy of President Macky Sall for internal and external affairs and the president of the Economic, Social and Environmental Council of Senegal. Welcome, Her Excellency. The fourth panelist is His Excellency Jomaa Mehdi, his former Prime Minister of Tunisia and also a member of the Club de Madrid. So all four panelists, all members of the Club de Madrid, welcome. It's good to be with you, Mehdi. The fifth and final panelist is Dr. Vera Songwe, UN Secretary, Under Secretary General and Executive Secretary of the Economic Commission for Africa. She became the first woman to lead the institution in 6 years and has been listed as one of the most influential women and people in Africa by different magazines, including Forbes and Jeune Afrique. Under her leadership, UNECA has been at the forefront of the fight against COVID, providing true partnership to African policymakers and working closely with the African Union envoys. So welcome, Vera.
Good afternoon.
Yeah, so let me begin by going back to the question I posed at the beginning, which is, what is your view on the current challenge to multilateralism, looking at it from an African perspective? And would you consider the current global crisis as an opportunity for Africa to reposition itself at the forefront of a new multilateral system? If I may begin with you, Your Excellency Chissano.
Thank you. You allow me to read because to articulate in English is very difficult for me. Since a long time, I don't go around these practices. But multilateralism is indeed being continuously challenged. The challenges come first and foremost from some major powers which go on acting unrestrained by existing norms, laws, and institutions in their use of force overseas. This has been causing loss of confidence in norms, laws, and institutions as instruments for protecting states' security. Consequently, various states, especially in the developing world, in Africa, have reinforced their selfish sense in defending their supreme national interests, being security on top. After decades in which multilateralism had consolidated its place as the main vehicle that shaped the international order, in recent years, it has seen a growing trend towards unilateralism that has become glaringly apparent, particularly after the rise of the current administration in the United States of America and in a number of other countries that have increasingly been following a narrow nationalist path. I will not name them. In recent years, the multilateral fora have achieved minimal success in dealing with transnational problems such as climate change, migration, and transnational crimes against humanity. Moreover, in discussing these problems, the voice and the interests of developing countries have been overpowered by the voice and interests of the great powers. This has been a strong motive for discredit of some multilateral fora and or mechanisms of problem solving. In a world of fierce competition for resources, influence, and tensions around competing values, in which rogue power or might in its multifaceted dimensions is still a blunt instrument that is leveraged by the powerful to exert their influence for Africa. For Africa, multilateralism in its many shapes is not, therefore, an option, but an imperative. This is because, whether in economic terms or strategic terms, no African nation can claim the ability to withstand the pressure of the powerful or summon the power to engage the world to impose its own will, no matter how reasonable its agenda might be. The most profound challenge to multilateralism comes, however, from recurring cycles of global financial and economic crises that impact heavily on the socioeconomic and political stability of developing countries, chiefly in Africa. This is aggravated by the fact that some African countries suffer from recurring climate disasters that put people in endless state of vulnerability. Sensitive to these difficult contexts, multilateral fora express solidarity, which in most cases includes pleas of urgent financial support. However, the pleas usually end up in promises hardly materialized. When materialized, the support has always been far behind what was promised because of various factors, including the effects of global financial and economic crises, as well as conditionalism that African states consider offensive to sovereignty. Africa cannot face the challenge of securing peace and security and engender socioeconomic development without following the path of collaboration and cooperation in multifaceted ways to address the challenges of underdevelopment, poverty, and improve human rights and democratic governance. The framework created through the establishment of the African Union and its institutions that has its pillars on sub-regional organizations and building blocks has proved to be a robust mechanism to develop the norms, rules, and institutions that respond in a more agile way to many of the challenges that occur in their jurisdiction. The approach based on sub-regional blocks also has an advantage that it makes it easier to adopt a course of action that facilitates legitimacy as it can address visible problems and produce results, project inclusiveness, and enhance representation, which lead wider acceptance. The sub-regional approach fits nearly into the continental architecture of the African Union, which enhances the legitimacy of the continental organization, but mirroring the reality projected by the sub-regions in its decision, lending credibility to the principle of subsidiarity and an hierarchy of interventions between the continental and the sub-regional levels. One of the many highly positive aspects is that the organs are structured to tackle and respond primarily to the internal needs of the continent, rather to simply relay the challenges of the continent to the global multilateral system with due consideration of consensus views at the continental level on any challenge, thus rendering more credibility to its intervention on the world stage. The system is also an enabler of agenda setting by consensus, which enables Africa to articulate common positions that carry the weight and the credibility of representing the views and aspirations of an entire continent. Examples include the African Common Position on the reform of the Security Council of the United Nations, or the crafting and approval of the Pan-African Development Blueprint encapsulated in Agenda 263 that enabled Africa to negotiate with one voice in a position of strength when the United Nations Agenda 2030 for Sustainable Development was being crafted. To magnify the collective approach to global agenda setting is the ability of building a continental consensus on representation of Africa in international bodies. On many occasions, continental consensus has enabled Africa to deploy its candidates in international organizations, thanks to the ability to use its collective might and block voting to secure seats or claim representation. And this has not always worked it should be. There were cases where the very African betrayed their own cause. On the other hand, maintaining a Pan-African position in certain issues has enabled Africa to stand in solidarity and withstand the pressure brought to bear on individual countries by the powerful nations or blocs to force them to distance themselves from a collective position. equally important.
Your Excellency, we're running a bit out of time. If you can to wrap up in the next few seconds.
Okay, let me now then go to. To say only to touch on what you said. Apart from education, I want to say the last paragraph.
There will be another round of questions that will give you opportunity to get some of the points in.
Yeah, the question is that I was not instructed to do this. I was instructed to sum up, to put the challenges Africa is facing. And so I wasn't prepared to answer a precise question on this. So I had the challenges of Africa. Okay, anyway, so I may stop here, but what I want to say is that time has come that African multilateral fora and health community play active role producing vaccines to curb the COVID-19 pandemic and above all other pandemic diseases such as malaria and cholera. I may stop there.
Now, sir, thank you for those opening remarks. I think the points that you highlight are indeed excellent points. And we have the opportunity to come back and discuss some of these in more detail. I'm also told a couple of our panelists are having, continue to have technical difficulties connecting, notably Senegal's former Prime Minister Aminata Touré, and also John Kufuor, former President of Ghana. These are the realities we live in with technology, you can never be sure. Oh, I see that Aminata was just able to join. But if we can move on to our next panelist, and if I can ask you to keep the opening remarks quite brief. Yeah, welcome. It's good to see you, Aminata.
Thank you. From the beginning, actually.
Yes, yeah, so we're now having opening statements, and then we'll come to you.
All right.
Yes, maybe if you can provide your opening statements. In a brief way, that would be really appreciated. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. So, you're do muted. I have the floor?
We'll come to you, Aminata.
All right. So,
Mehdi, you're muted. You are still muted. Can you hear us?
I hear you. And you?
Yes, now we can hear you.
Okay. So, briefly, two remarks. One, that we see that there is big changes, global changes today. We are living the period where we were dreaming about happy globalization with some weaknesses that we pointed out. And we see that there is an acceleration in the change in the world, and we see the necessity to have to adapt the new governance, the global governance, including the UN organization and all the other globalization to the new situation. We are living as well a kind of trade war. We lived this COVID crisis, and you see the lack of solidarity. And in the meantime, we have global threats, but the answer is not that's as global as we were expecting, or as global as the phenomena. In the COVID, instead of having solidarity, global solidarity, international solidarity, we are more in a racing or in a competition. In front of that, we know that we will emerge a new balance, a new equilibrium in the world and Africa, which is still now maybe seen as a beneficiary of the multilateralism, which is true for some aspects, should be a stakeholder and an actor. So I think that the COVID is a crisis, is a threat, is generating some problem, but it's an opportunity for us really to have a consultation in the frame of the different African organizations like the African Union, like the African Bank, to prepare really our contribution to the new order. Africa is a quarter of 1 billion. I think it's 1 billion people. It's one of the biggest potential development and investment in the world, and it has many riches, wealth. I mean, say the riches, research. Yeah. I think we have to be aware of that and to be a part of the new order, of the new regulation, and to contribute in to this new governance of the world. Just one remark about the COVID crisis. We are focusing on the health aspect of the COVID crisis, which is mandatory, which is very important. And we see that in this crisis, we have to rely on the solidarity. We don't have any research on the vaccine, on how to treat this phenomena. And through that, we see the importance for us of the multilateralism, but as well, how now to handle and how to treat consequences of this epidemic, which we knew would be huge consequences on social, economical security as well, and even on the stability of the, some countries. And we need really to be a part of this international system, because we have poor countries which will rely on that. We have middle income countries which will have which will need big needs of financial and technology and financial needs. So it's important to be a part of this worldwide and global organization, because in the same time, when you see, I mean, the big countries or the developed countries or the high level or the high economy level countries, they have the means, they have international presence, they have international assets through their big companies, but as well, they have good position in the different governance or different international organizations to ensure to be able to invest in a plan for economic and social recovery. So we need really to be actor of that. We need to have our place. We need to prepare our answer, collective answer, and as well, we need to be a part of the future. We are speaking about the crisis, but as well, the future will be made with technology, and we don't have to miss this stage or this step of jumping on the technology to be a part as well in the future. Thank you.
Yes, thank you, Mehdi. I was just told that we're able to get a connection for the President Kufuor. Can you hear us? Okay, so why don't we move on then to the next panelist? Aminata Touré, your opening remarks, please.
That belong.
You're muted.
For organizing this, do you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you now.
Okay, wonderful. So I would like to make some points, starting by saying that the first collateral of the COVID was multilateralism. if there is one area where you know, we have failed, is within multilateralism. What we have seen, and the Prime Minister just talked about it, what we have seen is really a regression when it comes to international cooperation. You can put it that way, that multilateralism means the actors we have seen from countries, the international trade class, it has been really that way. So now what we need to do is, how are we going to regain dignity for international cooperation? And from a standpoint here in Africa, what we have seen were two things. First of all, as usual, we suffered from the same stereotyping. You know, it was announced, and in very serious places, that African will die by millions. We haven't seen that so far, and hopefully at the end of this pandemic, we will see international cues. It is important because it shows how stereotyped international cooperation is, and that is something that we need to get rid of. Second, what we have seen is very strong resilience from countries. I can speak from my own, Senegal. I think the international scene acknowledged, you know, that we handled pretty well, you know, this COVID crisis. And it's the same in many, many African countries. Because we have built upon our experience and skills in managing pandemics, so that the world should have known that. And we've been quite successful on that. We still cross fingers. Hopefully, the situation will get better and better. So now, what we need to do, if we want to regain confidence from the African people, particularly young people, we have to make sure that international cooperation, multilateralism, speak to their basic needs and rights. There is no international cooperation that makes sense to the African women, the African young people, if it doesn't impact on its daily life. It requires change of habit and behavior. Cooperation, international cooperation, must, to make sense, and insist on stronger capacities, stronger resilience for the health system, since we are talking about the COVID crisis. It required a genuine sharing of medical knowledge, genuine sharing of medical technology. That's what I see. If you want to rehabilitate multilateralism that has disappeared completely in the face of the world when the crisis started, and we have to come back to that. I think multilateralism must regain and re-own the human rights agenda. It seems to be critical to me. International cooperation only will make sense if it addresses the needs of people who needs to be supported. That's from the African standpoint what I see. Now, when we talk about multilateralism, we tend to think that we speak to North-South relationship. That's one aspect of it. But I would like to see more within the African continent. To multilateral, we do know that we only trade 16% among ourselves with countries. But in Europe, it's 60%. So we have to develop our international, African, in areas we understand together, and something to define ourselves. We have to make sure that African Union, we have to make sure that our people are strong and in the rights of the people. Talk about health. Today, we have suffered together in South, but as a matter of fact, North suffer much more. So they can, what it means, have access to health. So now, I think we are speaking the same language, able to sit around the table and agenda, an international agenda that we advance the situation of the people. That's really, really the next challenge of multilateralism. If it wants to retain its own dignity and it wants to remain relevant to the people, I think that is very important. And how to do that? I think there is two areas. If we succeed on that, it would be a good thing. From an African point of view, I'm speaking, of course. As I say, we have to make sure that we have interventions that go directly within the health system. We have to make sure that the skills, the technical skills, get strengthened. We have to make sure that we have access And what we have seen also is many countries developing their own internal expertise and dealing in a very effective way. And that is a new spirit from Africa that needs to be expanded to all the areas, be it economic, be it cultural, etc. So we can get out of this pandemic being more confident in ourselves, being more self developing ourselves, but of course, building new relationship with the rest of the world. When we speak to Africa, it's very, very important that we develop our own pharmaceutical business. We cannot continue to rely on external pharmaceutical product.
Thank you, Prime Minister Touré, thank you for those remarks. Basically, multilateralism puts people's basic needs at the center of it, otherwise it's not working. If we can now turn to Vera Songwe from UNECA for your opening remarks.
Thank you. Greetings to all your excellencies on the call. Listen, I think, and thanks again to the Club of Madrid and all the other sponsors for bringing us together to have this, a very important conversation. For me, 4 points that I just want to raise, and I'll come back to them during the course of the conversation. The first one is about voice. I think multilateralism means inclusion. For me, multilateralism doesn't mean that somebody has to be in front. It means that we all have to go together. And part of that has to be that we sit around the same tables and analyze our problems together. And so when we look at the global institutions, we see the question of voice is still lacking. And that starts with, of course, the UN Security Council, and then it cascades downwards. And I think it's important that we think about that as we talk about a redefined and reset multilateralism in the face of this crisis. The second one is finance. I think we have all seen with the COVID crisis, which is a crisis like we have never seen in a century hit us. And what has happened is the developed world, of course, has come together, and justifiably so and rightly so, and put a bottom under this crisis for their economies, but not for the rest of the world. However, we are interdependent, and we see that when global supply chains break, they break for all of us. So when we could not find test kits in Africa, we couldn't find test kits in Canada or the United States. And so it's important that, when we talk about how we finance some of these crises, we're able to do that in a consistent fashion. However, I have to say, and I know that there is a lot of conversation around sort of the fraying multilateralism, but I would say that when the African finance ministers came together and called for a debt relief, called for $100 billion in additional support, the G20 did pick up that call, and we did get the debt service suspension initiative. We got it very timidly. So for me, it's not so much a retreat of multilateralism as it is a timidity in the multilateralism that we see today, particularly in the financial space. And I think when we are faced with a crisis like this one, we need an aggressive multilateralism. We've just heard the G20 say that they're going to extend the debt service suspension initiative, which stands to put about another $13 billion back into the hands of Africa to respond to the crisis. They would only extend it for 6 months as opposed to 1 year. Why the timidity? Why the lack of courage to address such a powerful crisis as we are facing. If we cannot be bold today, when will we be? And so I think that that is, for me, the question around multilateralism. It's not so much whether it's retreating, it's just what is the boldness of it? And that reminds me of 2008, 2009, when we faced the financial crisis. That is where the G20 was born. It was because America was bold, President George Bush was bold at the time, and he said the G7 cannot answer these questions, let's bring together a G20, let's bring the rest of the world, or at least the larger part of the world. Africa got in, with South Africa, maybe we need a G30 or something with a little bit more African countries so that we can get in and have a bit better conversation. The third issue is trade. Of course, I think the Prime Minister of Senegal has just said, Africa trades 2% with the rest of the world. I think that's a dismal figure. It means essentially that, you know, other than our commodities, we're not able to access many markets. One of the reasons why we're not able to do that is something called phytosanitary conditions. And we need to, again, in the space and just see how conditions that are prior conditions that we put before in 1960 that we need to revise. Africa has come together in one, speaking in one voice under the Continental Free Trade Area Agreement to sort of see how they can go forward. I think Chissano said sometimes when we come together, all of us don't come together. And so we also need to, I think, pay attention not to romanticize multilateralism in Africa. We've been trying to pass and ratify the African Continental Free Trade Area Agreement for the last 18 months. We have 30 countries. It means that we still have a few holdouts. We will need all of Africa to join the CFTA if Africa does want to talk in one voice about multilateralism. So I think we also need to look into the continent to see how we can do that better. And finally, on migration is the last point that I want to talk about, which is the sort of the social impacts on the continent. I think the Secretary General, the UN Secretary General, has put together a global compact on migration. But there again, there is a frame. There's a frame within Africa about the conversations around migration. There is a frame without Africa about how Africans travel outside the continent. So I think there again, we need to see a different kind of conversation, and particularly so during this period of the COVID crisis. We actually see countries, you know, sending back migrants onto the continent to various countries that don't have the capacity or the ability to handle this. And here we need some kind of international institutions that manage that problem. So four things for me: voice, finance, trade, and migration, I think should begin to define the new multilateralism and the reset as we go forward. Thank you.
So thank you, Vera, for those very insightful remarks. If I can just follow up with one question for our previous three panelists. If you look back to your time in office, in this moment, what is the one thing you would have done differently, or you would have done now in the context of this crisis? I can start with His Excellency Chissano.
Yeah, thank you very much. If I have to be frank with you, it would be very difficult to say what I could have done because the circumstances obliged us to do things. Even if we were not very much ready to do them, because of this weak response of multilateralism, while imposing, I would not call principles, what was called principles on you, and not giving you the chance to gather the means to fulfill your obligations, it would go to an adverse situation. And you could not say, I choose this or choose that to do. You have to do what is agreed by a group of powers, or even by one power, which itself would not facilitate your life if you tried to do something different. So what I could do today, I could not have done it in the past due to those circumstances. So I think that today the United States is showing us that even today, it's very difficult to take steps according to the will of the poor countries because dependency is still there. We don't have the means, we don't have the qualified personnel which could do things like industrializing our country, industrializing it in the real sense, not just to put spares together and resembling some machines, but to make machines, to use the raw materials you have for development, and so that we come to a real cooperation, to a real multilateralism. Multilateralism should be not just obeying to an order which was established by the powerful, but I would not do many things. I would not do many things different from what I did, because I was always struggling for inclusion in the international community. I was struggling together with my peers for a democratic structures of the United Nations. And we're struggling for a very strong African Union, which could make the difference. We're struggling to bring know-how and transfer of technology, which I cannot say that it happened today. And transfer of technology is still far. We have many universities, but still people who come from there depend on the foreigners to implement projects, programs of development in our country. Let's say build bridges, build the roads, build dams, to master all these technologies, let alone the new technologies. So we're still very far, we're still depending. And so I would continue doing what I was doing, maybe with the joint efforts of Africa. Maybe we would start getting to where we want to go. That's why I'm very much hopeful that the new agenda may be seen in a different way by all of us, because this question of cohesion of African. It's a problem, but say cooperation among ourselves. Mm-hmm. I think I would still stick to that path, that we have to cooperate among ourselves, be strong so that we can cooperate with the powerful ones.
Thank you. We have one question coming in from the audience. If I might call on you, Prime Minister Mehdi. They say, how African Agenda 2063 and SDG implementation will be affected by COVID and the economic crisis?
It depends on the country, but in general, there is a big impact on the economies with the confinement, with the stopping large sectors. If I take the example of my country, Tunisia, one of the most dynamic and important sector activity is tourism. It's close to nothing this year. So it's a very big impact, and that's why to answer your previous question, what is the action or the decision that you glad if we were about this commitment, risks about the direct, on the health. I think one of the things I said that we don't have any research or we are not involved in the research for vaccine or for medicines. But what we can add,
you're frozen. Can you hear
at
us?
Least, in groups of countries or as Africa, is to see how we can be involved tomorrow. It will be made by countries like the United States, Europe, Russia, China, and we will not be the first rank to be vaccinated. I mean, to take advantage from that. It's really now to be involved in that and to set up the industrial organization and the supply chain organization to be able to bring that as soon as possible and to limit the consequences of that. So we are on the risk in our countries, not only economic impact, but social environment and security. And one of the decisions is to ask us today to see how we can recover from that situation, the problem of employment. You saw in Europe, in China, and the US, they have the means and the collective organization to be able to support their companies, to support the employment problem, to support them from coming to going under the chapter 11. We don't have that. And the minimum today to do as this is to discuss together how we can find an African answer to these problems, which are different from Europe and which are different from US. And in that way, I'm emphasizing on the fact that the multilateral facing this crisis are important and are very important for us in Africa.
Thank you. And for the next question, if I might call on you, Prime Minister Touré, is the African Union's current mandate and institution, are they well prepared for facing the continent's challenges?
I think so, yes. That's what I want to say.
All sectors, I think the African Union is the greatest platform we have if we make it work. That's the question. That's the only place where all countries come together and reflect on our common issues and try to come. It has to be relevant at country level. So that's always the balance that is how we give sovereignty to African Union, and how much do you want to retain at national level, being aware that authorities are elected at national level. So that, the dichotomy that we face. But I do believe, as I said in my previous statement, that it is very important that we look at some of our issues, continent point of view. The first point that we need to gain is our pharmaceutical sovereignty as Africa. And for that, we have to reflect whether at sub-regional level or at continental level, both being possible. We have to rely on our own industry, Africa-wise or sub-regional-wise. So I do think that we do have the platform itself, but it's only relevant if it is able, the African Union, to drive common projects and make them relevant all the way to the citizen. So that has been a challenge so far. We do have NEPAD, as you know, the new initiative for partnership in Africa. It was very promising, but it has not been implemented actually. That's the situation we face ourselves in. But what we have learned from COVID very clearly is that we do have opportunities, we do have the skills, how are we going to piggyback on each other's advantages for our common good? So that's what it is. But this is a philosophical answer I'm giving you. The pudding being in the eating, the whole idea of putting forward joint programming, joint projects in the area of health, in the area of education, in the area of basic infrastructure is more relevant than in the recent past. So I do think that it should be one of the key objectives of the African Union, providing first we establish a climate of peace, stability in the country. So that is also another challenge that we have to face. More than ever, peace has to come. Peace has to be sustained if we want our promises to materialize. So we have to combine at the African Union level this peace and stability searching with the joint project in the area of health in terms of very advanced facilities. We should be able to go across the continent to find good infrastructures. And that is the issue. So it depends of how much a political will we give to African Union. That has been the issue always. It's a question posed to all of us in the continent, posed to the government. But one thing is sure, we do have, if you look into our countries, the same issues, youth, African youth, whether it's in Senegal or Zimbabwe or Cairo or South Africa, they have the same aspiration. They have the same, willingness. And we should really to them. And African Union is, as I said, a great platform that can bring us together.
Yes, thank you, Prime Minister Touré. So if I may now turn to you, Vera. You mentioned earlier in your third point about what's not working well in multilateralism or the key issue touching on trade, with Africa only trading 2% with the rest of the world. We now have a new leadership at the WTO, and I've heard you stress in the past how commodity trade has always dominated African trade, and we need to move away from that to now move into more value creation. So WTO, a very important institution in the multilateral system, has new leadership. What can you see as some of the one or two most important things that the WTO can do differently to facilitate a greater role for Africa in the global trade?
Thank you, Brahima. I think two things, and maybe not facilitate a greater role for Africa, but and most of the time when Africa speaks, people always think Africa wants different. My sense will be Africa wants a level playing field. And so the question will be, what can we do to get a level playing field? Because we have not had a level playing field in the past. And so it's not so much of a greater role. I think I gave you the example of phytosanitary conditions. We cannot export a lot of our agriculture products because of the definitions of, what meets and what qualifies as phytosanitary when it's going into Europe, for example. And I think we now need to level some of those agreements. I think when we talk a lot about subsidies, we know that, the allowances for subsidies are different in the United States, in Europe, and in Africa. And so again, we can level some of those things, and hopefully that's something that the WTO will be able to do. But most importantly, I think, is in the area of e-commerce. I think we know now, coming out of this crisis, that e-commerce is going to be a game changer, a defining characteristic of how we build forward from the crisis. And particularly as the Prime Minister of Senegal has been saying, if we want to create jobs for our youth, we're going to have a different regulatory regime globally for e-commerce and telecommunications. And I think one of the things that the African Union has done, working with the Economic Commission for Africa, the World Bank, and many others, is last year already we had a strategy for technology at the global African Union level. Now we need to put that in place. Africa is at the forefront of, trying to see what are the standards for e-commerce. And my hope is that as we get into a new conversation on trade, industrial policy, competition policy, very, very important. Procurement. I think there's a number of things when we look even at Africa's procurement, if you look at how much each of our countries spends as a share of its budget on external procurement, it's quite important. And my final point, I think when the Prime Minister of Senegal talks about pharmaceuticals, we import $14.7 billion worth of drugs. That's 96.5% of the drugs consumed across Africa are imported from the European Union, 55%, and then China and India. China does not allow Africans to export drugs to China from Africa. So I think we do need to look at that. The good news is that in countries like Senegal, I must congratulate Senegal, they are the only African country that actually produces vaccines today. They produce the polio vaccine. So as we begin to talk about a vaccine for COVID and we begin to talk about domesticating production, I think countries like Senegal, of course, Egypt, South Africa are front in line to see whether we can bring some of those things home. The African Continental Free Trade Area Agreement is really looking at how we can then leverage, you know, some of our global comparative advantages continentally before we export. And so I think as the WTO and the World Trade Organizations come together, it's really about leveling the playing field and giving Africa the same chances like everybody else.
Okay, that's wonderful. Great, thank you, Vera. I think we're getting close to the end of the time, our time here, and I think it's been a very fascinating and informing conversation. Rightfully so, President Chissano mentioned how we're seeing a little bit more deprioritization of international cooperation in some corners of the world and reversion toward a bit of autarky. But I think we could observe also in terms of good news that Africa is bucking that that trend and is actually increasingly stating in no unequivocal term its inclination to integrate more with itself and to play a bigger role. And Prime Minister Mehdi touched on the role of those key institutions, notably African Union, the African Development Bank, as well as some of the natural resources and assets that we have that can allow Africa to strengthen its position. And Prime Minister Touré, your message about multilateralism, however we want to imagine it, it is not what it should be unless it is really catering to the basic needs of being able to provide health, contribute to skills development, and then access really to and then human rights as well, and access to clean water, sanitation. Unless it's able to deliver on all of that, it is not the multilateralism. And you look at population growth, Africa is going to be increasingly home to the largest share of the global population. So if globalization and multilateralism doesn't work for Africa, I think its promise is going to remain elusive and an incomplete agenda at best. And whereas your main 4 points, to think of multilateralism more as a timidity when it comes to approaches in terms of the way we've seen it play out in this mastering the financial support to be able to assist African countries is well taken. What we've seen is when the crisis hit, you had interest rates in global economies, with advanced economies that dropped a lot, which allowed them and facilitated a lot of reaction to the pandemic. But on the other hand, for African countries, interest rates went up drastically, and they were de facto shut out from the international market. So this is a clear case of when the global financial system market did not work for Africa, and where Africa was expecting more bolder and more decisive action from the global financial community. And the progress that has been made and support that has been provided is helped the countries. And we hope we can have a multilateral system that would be able to more swiftly respond to the need of those in Africa and also other developing world, so it works for all countries. Our apologies that we could not get President Kufuor to join, and thank you all for the patience with the technologies. It's just that we are at the mercy of that technology in these days, and we certainly appreciate your patience. So let me conclude by again thanking a lot the Club of Madrid for this session. And the very fact that you put this session on the agenda, I think is a fair, is an important step and signal to show the inclusion that we've touched on, and Vera's first point about a matter of inclusion and voice. And today, I think the African continent has had a voice in key members and well-respected statesmen, as well as scholars and leaders on the continent. And we very much appreciate that. And hopefully we'll get further conversation down the road where we can hear the viewpoints of the president of Ghana, the former president of Ghana. With that, we can end here. And thank you very much. I turn it over to you.
And thank you so much, Dr. Coulibaly, and also all of the speakers in that very interesting and insightful session, and those technical difficulties that Brahima Coulibaly just mentioned. Of course, they only underline how important our sub-theme this year is, the sub-theme of digitalization. Given the fact that we're a bit over our time, I will spare you a lengthy summary of this very important first day of our policy dialogue, and simply say I think we have heard some very compelling calls for boosting multilateralism to truly ensure that it delivers the kind of solutions to the problems that are reinforcing both inequality and holding back sustainable development for people and the planet. Some of those problems have been very powerfully outlined by the speakers we have heard this afternoon. So many thanks to all of them. And tomorrow we will resume with a look at how we boost multilateralism and an exploration of an alliance that is seeking to do just that. But first, we have an opportunity for some virtual networking. Normally, we would now all enjoy some fellowship and refreshments. Unfortunately, we have to forgo the latter, but we can at least do some virtual visiting with one another during the next quarter of an hour. As noted earlier, you can access the four different networking rooms through the networking area on the website. You'll see that we have rooms for multilateralism, social justice and inclusion, and sustainability. And I do urge you to go there and visit a little bit with your fellow participants. I wish everybody a pleasant close to this day, and I look forward to seeing you back here tomorrow morning, 9 a.m. German time, for that session on boosting multilateralism with a panel of high-ranking leaders who are joining forces to support international cooperation. See you then. Bye-bye.